for joining us at Text Messages here, ladies and gentlemen. I'm Rick Tex, the parasite of the show. Well, it's actually Text Messages to Resurrection. We're elated to have you joining us here on this Wednesday evening, January 23rd, 2019. This is segment two of our narrow cast of the evening. We're broadcasting out of Elk River, Minnesota. All right, so what we wanted to discuss today, it's a very important topic. It's about a hemoglobin. Hemoglobin is in your blood, and what it does is it's a conduit towards the production of red blood cells. And the red blood cells, essentially, they're a protein. Well, the hemoglobin is a protein found in red blood cells responsible for carrying oxygen from your lungs into your vital parts of your body that need it. And it carries the carbon dioxide out of the body into the lungs, and then you breathe the carbon dioxide out. See, that's why humans need to exist symbiotically with plants, because plants, generally, I mean, plants do respirate carbon dioxide as well, but by and large, they're more so carbon dioxide intakes than outtakes. And as a percentage of the actual environmental air, say, it might be 70% nitrogen, 20-some percent oxygen, and then a bunch of garbage, you know, other garbage. And carbon dioxide is probably part of that other garbage. I mean, it's not technically garbage, but it, according to our statistics, it's about 400 parts per million inside the environment, which has steadily gone up since about they could first measure it. Now, as far as how they measure carbon dioxide levels back in, say, back before Christ or way back in the good old days, apparently they get some rock or they find some ice forms and then break the ice and then figure out what the composition of chemical compounds are in there, and then through that they can determine what the carbon dioxide levels were. Something along those lines. It was very, very, I wasn't able to find a clear enough explanation for it. But there is one out there. Now, I'm not saying there isn't one out there. I just didn't look that hard. That's really the gist of the story there. Now hemoglobin, it's very important. You know, blood is very important, obviously. Does a whole lot of things for you. It carries hormones from point A to point B where it needs to be. You've probably heard of things getting in your blood that shouldn't be in there. Alcohol, for example, that's definitely one of them. See, when you drink alcohol and it says your level is like 0.01% or 0.1% or something like that. See, I mean, that's just having that small of a percentage of your blood displaced by a useless chemical, you know, creates the very deleterious effects that result in blacking out or not being able to operate a motor vehicle safely. So, I mean, your blood is very important. You want to keep it nice and thick and flowing freely and not obstructed and all that good fun stuff, too. So one of the ways to help out with hemoglobin is to increase your iron intake. Now, well water generally has iron in it. So if you're drinking good, healthy well water that doesn't, you know, filter out all the iron, you should be getting a pretty good supply there. But iron boosts the production of hemoglobin, and some of the food items that you can find them in, and these are organic sources here, not garbage factory farm or commercial raised and all that. Meat and fish have it, tofu, eggs, dried fruits like figs and apricots, broccoli, cauliflower, leafy vegetables, green beans, nuts and seeds, and peanut butter. Now peanut butter you got to be definitely afraid of, or cautious of, because there is some peanut butter out there that just has a whole bunch of trans fats, which are extremely unhealthy. They're a fat that's a solid at room temperature, 70 degrees. So you typically want to avoid that. And with green beans and stuff like that too, you can get frozen green beans or canned green beans. Definitely go with the frozen ones. Sort of locks in the vitamins and minerals, whereas when they can stuff, they basically heat it up to a very high temperature and then put a bunch of weird preservatives on it. So not really sure what you're getting out of that. Plus it's exposed to, you know, the tin inside the can, which probably has dangerous chemicals in it as well. Obviously the plastic bag with that frozen foods coming also probably has dangerous chemicals, so I mean, I suppose that's a one-to-one comparison of the tin can to the frozen ones. But the thing is, with a tin can, if you put a liquid inside the can, the entire liquid is making contact with the can. So the surface area of dangerous chemical leachate is greater than with the plastic bagger on the frozen vegetables, because only actually a very, very small surface area of the frozen vegetables will be making contact with the actual plastic bag. So with that in mind, you could say that there's a lot less leachate inside the plastic bags as opposed to the tin cans, which is another good reason to get frozen foods instead of tin foods. And then, of course, you can find organic, definitely get them too. Increasing folate intake. Folate is a type of vitamin B which produces heme. Red blood cells will not be able to mature without folate, you know, the heme. You can find folate in beef, spinach, rice, peanuts, black-eyed peas, kidney beans, avocados, and lettuce. We talked about avocados earlier. There's just a deluge of healthy things in there. This is what I've noticed over the years, ladies and gentlemen. I'll do all this research and think, oh, you know, maybe I got a shortage of vitamin B, or I got a shortage of carotenoids, or a shortage of vitamin A. And then typically look at all the foods that it consists of, and it's pretty much everything that I'm already generally consuming. So if you're eating a pretty healthy, clean diet, and you're very conscious about what you eat, and you go to the grocery store and you kind of enjoy going to the grocery store and looking around and looking at labels and poking around and things, and maybe searching some random websites from medicalnewstoday.com, healthline.com, naturalnews.com, naturalhealth365.com. All those websites do provide pretty useful information. And everything that I've learned is definitely self-experimentation and a lot of just years of trial and error. I mean, sometimes you might think dark chocolate is really bad for you, but then it turns out that you're eating something else that was causing bad symptoms, so you attributed it to the chocolate because due to a mischaracterization. That's why in the beginning of the show, sometimes we'll say we're experimenting with sound quality or video quality, and we're just going to do one adjustment at a time and do that for a few days or weeks and see how it goes. Because if you add too many variables into an equation, you're not going to find the right answer over time. Now, you will get better, but it happens sort of like a sine wave. It oscillates. I mean, the general trajectory is up, but you sort of go up and down on that upwards path. And then when you get to the end, well, you know, I mean, all of us will get to the end at some point. But when you do get there, you will not have really... See, it's more of a slow burn, because when you make the conscious decision to be a healthy person and be great again and all that, you generally just want to go pile up on foods that are good for you. And that's probably a prudent strategy. But if you suspect that maybe you're eating way too much fiber, or you're eating your ratio of fats to protein is completely out of control. So there's also a lot of that macronutrient ratio that plays into being healthy as well. So, but overall, getting back to the original point, you'll read about all these healthy vitamins, minerals that do great things, and if you're eating decent food from the start, you're gonna read everything and think, oh, well, I'm already probably consuming 2 out of the 5 or 3 out of the 5 or something like that. And maybe you don't consume lettuce because it probably just riddled with pesticides and you always get vomiting after you eat it. So, but avocados or rice or peanuts or spinach, beef, all that good fun stuff, pretty much available to just about anybody in America. And number maximizing iron absorption. See, we talked about increasing iron intake. So you want to increase iron absorption. Because if you just eat a whole bunch of iron but you can't absorb it, then it's probably just gonna expel it from your body. So foods rich in vitamin C, such as citrus, strawberries, leafy green vegetables, will absolutely help with iron absorption. Vitamin A and beta-carotene. Some of the foods that have these items in them are fish, liver, squash, sweet potatoes, kale, and collards. They all have vitamin A. Carrots, sweet potatoes, squash, cantaloupes, and mangoes have carotenoids. Mangoes definitely have a lot of vitamin C. Basically, any fruit, citrus-type fruit, will have vitamin E. Pineapple, strawberry, blueberries, apples, oranges, lemon, lime, mangoes. All that stuff will have it. So if you're eating 1 to 2 servings of fruit per day, you're probably getting plenty of vitamin C. But if you're doing the ketogenic diet and not eating any types of fruit per day, then you're going to have to get the vitamin C through things like vegetables, carrots, sweet potatoes, squash, things of that nature that are low carbohydrate, and, you know, spinach and leafy green vegetables. Now, vitamin A can be dangerous in high quantities, so it is important to not get too out of control with that. See, vitamin A is a fat-soluble vitamin, so if you're not eating a lot of fat and you're eating a ton of vitamin A, it might cause some problems. So if you're eating a lot of fat and you're eating a lot of vitamin A, you're probably going to be good. Now, when hemoglobin is measured, low hemoglobin is considered under below 13.5 grams per deciliter. And 13.5 to 17.5 is considered healthy for males. 12 to 15.5 is considered healthy for females. So if you ever get a blood test and you got your little numbers on a piece of paper, and that's kind of what you're looking for. So if you're on the low end of that and you're doing a lot of exercise and weightlifting and things like that, it is a bit alarming, and it's something you should probably look into. I mean, if you're just sitting around all day and watching video games and people playing video games online and commenting about them, then 13.5 is probably a pretty decent number. But for active people, you know, just use exercise common sense is basically what I'm trying to sell you here, ladies and gentlemen. Now, some of the symptoms of low hemoglobin are fast or irregular heartbeat, pale skin and gums, fatigue, frequent or unexplained bruising, and reoccurring headaches. A lot of this stuff sort of happens more in wintertime. For example, the air is drier, your skin gets drier, there's less oxygen in the air. So the oxygen is also a good carrier of the iron, which is why it's important just to have lots of good oxygen. Because if there isn't a lot of oxygen in the air, and the whole point of the hemoglobin is to carry oxygen, you're going to feel the symptoms of low iron. But in all actuality, it's just low oxygen. So there's also that to consider as well, ladies and gentlemen. So that being said, having iron is great and all. It'll hopefully make you great again. And we thank you for joining us. Without you, we're absolutely nothing. We appreciate your time and efforts and hope not to waste any of it. And thank you very much for watching.